His blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but I wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. But I am safe within your hands. When darkness veils His lovely face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. But I am safe within His hands. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. But I am safe within your hand. Yes, I am safe within your hand. Oh, I am safe within your hand.
His praises. One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men. My example is He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day. Oh, glorious day. One day they led Him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed Him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. Hands that heal nations, stretched out on a tree, and took the nails for me. 'Cause living He loved me,
Good morning. It is good to be in the house of the Lord, and it's good to have you joining us from home if you're watching our live stream this morning. And I don't know about you, but it's so nice lately to experience anything that feels like what the world was like pre-COVID, just to have a semblance of normalcy. And this week, we got a few glimpses of that. Yesterday, Jay and I were here to celebrate the marriage of Randy and Barbara Ferris. So we want to congratulate them. And it was just a lovely time together, just celebrating this special occasion for them. And we just want to show love to them. And it was just great to celebrate. Also, this past week, if you know Sean and Alana Moore, they welcomed a baby into this world, and so we're just so thankful for that, and that everyone's doing well. Ridley, I believe, is that correct? Yes. Yeah. It's there's more pressure when you're on a live stream because you can't take it back. But what we're going to do this morning, as I was thinking this week about the passage we'll be looking at this morning, is we're going to start with a responsive reading. And the reading that we're going to be doing, it takes passages from Scripture. And your job will be to respond with, Jesus Christ is the light of the world. And so with each of my readings, your response will echo that refrain, that Jesus Christ is the light of the world. And that is something we truly believe, that Jesus Christ is the light of the world. He is the truth. He is the way. And so let us read this together. It'll show up on the screen behind me. Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen on you.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
Nations will come to his light, and rulers will seek his radiance.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
He will judge the people with righteousness and defend the cause of the poor.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
The mystery of the ages is revealed. The eternal plan of God is known to all.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
Let us kneel down before him to give him honor, glory, and praise.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
Let us offer him all the treasures of our hearts and our lives.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
And let us worship Jesus Christ together this morning.
Would you stand with me this morning? We are going to sing a new song. It is a song called O Great God of Highest Hev. And it is an older song, but it's new to us. But it has got some very beautiful lyrics. And I want to read them to you. You are worthy to be praised with my every thought and deed. O great God of highest heaven, glorify your name through me. Let that be our prayer this morning. And so I would invite you to raise your voice with me this morning as we sing to the Lord.
Thank you. Oh, great God of highest heaven, occupy my lowly heart. Own it all and reign supreme, conquer every rebel power. Let no vice or sin remain that resists your holy war. You have loved and purchased me, make me yours forevermore. I was blinded by my sin, had no ears to hear your voice. Did not know your love within, had no taste for heaven's joys. Then your Spirit gave me life, opened up your word to me. Through the gospel of your Son, gave me endless hope and peace. On your grace, keep my heart and guard my soul from the evils that I face. You are worthy to be praised with my every thought and deed. Oh, great God of highest heaven, glorify your name through me. You are worthy. Thought and deed. Oh, great God of highest heaven, glorify your name through me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us go before him in his throne.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of old days, so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to You're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Lord, you are beautiful. And we look upon your face this morning. Show us your glory. Let us know your beauty intimately as we open your word and as we see you face to face. Amen. He is holy. Why don't we sing to him together? Father, he is the Son, and he is the Holy Spirit, a Trinity, a God who loves us. Amen. Hallelujah. Grab a seat.
Well, there is no God like our God, a holy God. One of the things that we are commanded to do in Scripture is to go and make disciples of all nations. And so one of the things that we like to highlight each month is those who are doing that very thing and those that we support through the work of, of missions throughout the world. And so this morning, we're just going to take a few moments to highlight some of those missionaries and just some ways that we can continue to pray for them as they adapt their ministry to this current situation that we're in. So we're going to have them come up on the screen in just a moment here. So the first couple that we'll be highlighting is Ken and Marianne Jolly. And Ken works for Simply Mobilizing, which works to train and equip leaders. And a lot of his work is training leaders in Central and South America. And he's also presently at home in Canada, pastoring in Port Elgin as well. But for many years, I believe they were working in Venezuela. So here's some ways that we can pray for them. As I mentioned, Ken has been working in Port Elgin at Shoreline Baptist Church, and he's helping in an interim role, and they're searching for a new pastor, so we can just pray for that process, especially now. Bringing in new pastors in the current situation is just a little bit more difficult. And they have a candidate that's been presented. Pray for Ken as he continues to mentor students through the Immerse program in Colombia and other servants around the globe. And then we also can just pray for, they're kind of working on trial online projects of moving these discipleship making programs like Simply Mobilizing, and Leaders Formation is another program that he's part of. They're trying to move that all online to do online training. And so just pray for those programs that Ken's a part of, that they would really see God's kingdom grow through those and disciples being made through those initiatives. So we can pray for that. The second ministry that we want to highlight is the Evangelical Seminary of Quebec. And I'm not going to try to pronounce the French pronunciation of that because my wife will laugh at me. But we can pray. SEMBEC is a ministry that is seeking to equip pastors and leaders within the local church, and they work mostly in Quebec. And so here's some ways we can pray. Pray that they'll be enabled to equip more and more leaders as they're now offering a master's degree program in biblical leadership. And pray that God would guide students in training to find the right place to serve as they're equipping these leaders, that they would find a church to serve in. And praise God just for the donations they received in last December. And it offers free tuition to some of their students. And so that's a real blessing. And just pray for the impact of, they just had it this past weekend, a course on Christian ethics that was held, especially considering the social constraints of the pandemic. And this is a ministry, not only the Evangelical Seminary of Quebec, but basically any ministry that's going on in Quebec. It's easy for us to forget just the needs in Quebec. It's one of the most neediest places for the gospel in the Americas. The percentage of evangelical believers in Quebec is the lowest in anywhere in all of the Americas. And so that's right next door. And so we just can pray for ministries like this that are doing work in Quebec. So at this time, we're going to pray for those things. We'll remind you as well, it'll show up on the screen, one of the ways you can give to these missionaries and to the ministry of Victory Baptist Church is through e-transfer. And if you're here with us today and you have a physical offering, we'll remind you that there's a white box at the door that you can put it in there as you leave. But let us pray for our offering and for these missionaries together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a God who does not change. You are a God who is ever present. And the constraints of a pandemic are nothing to you. And Lord, we just thank you for the ways that we see you continuing to work in our midst and around the world. We pray for Ken and Marianne as they continue their work from Canada. continue working as they serve at Shoreline Baptist Church, and we pray for their search for a pastor. But we also pray for these online initiatives and this online training that Ken continues to do. And we pray for just that would have a great impact in Central and South America. That as he trains leaders, that those that he disciples would go and make further disciples. That we would see just a movement of God in those places where there is such great need for the gospel, such great need for servants of Christ to go and give hope to those without hope. We also pray for the Evangelical Seminary of Quebec, and we thank you for the ministry that they are doing in that place. And we pray for the online courses that they are doing. We pray for the leaders that they are training up, that you would lead them to churches, Lord, where they can serve in their community and bring the gospel to that place. And we know the great need that Quebec has for Jesus Christ. And we pray that places like this seminary would raise up future leaders that would just have a heart and a passion to share the good news in that place. And may you raise even someone from our midst, Lord, that would have a heart to reach French-speaking Canadians for the gospel. And so, Lord, we bring these things before you, and we bring our gifts before you, Lord, knowing that you honor these gifts that we give to you as worship, Lord, and may they go towards the furthering of the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. Scripture this morning will be Mark chapter 9, verses 2 to 13, and that'll come up on the screen.
Today's scripture reading is Mark chapter 9, verses 2 to 13. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain, where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud. "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. They kept the matter to themselves, discussing what rising from the dead meant. And they asked him, "Why do the teachers of the law say that Elijah must come first?" Jesus replied, "To be sure, Elijah does come first and restores all things. Why then is it written that the Son of Man must suffer much and be rejected? But I tell you, Elijah has come, and they have done to him everything they wished, just as it is written about him." This is the word of the Lord.
Well, good morning. I love it. I see Bibles open. This is great. If you're not already there, please turn with me in your Bibles to Mark chapter 9. Mark chapter 9, it is so good for us to be together in the word of the Lord and allow him to direct us and teach us through his word. And before we begin, let's just invite God to be a part of our service here today and just speak to us. Heavenly Father, you, God, are our helper. You are the light in the darkness. And we ask that by your Holy Spirit that you do a great work within us this morning, that you would open our eyes as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, that our faith may be built up and strengthened in Jesus Christ. Help us in our doubt and our uncertainty. And we ask, Lord, that you forgive us of our sin. There's so many times that we have gone astray. Lord, we ask that through faith Christ may dwell in our hearts and that this morning we may get a glimpse of your glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. There is a stand-up comic that I like to listen to. His name is Nate Bargatze. In a recent performance, he started his set off by saying, "What a year, 2020. It's been one of my favorites." To which everybody started laughing because we know what the joke is. 2020 has been anything but a year that has been easy. It's been difficult for each and every one of us, and really worldwide. It's been hard, and it's not over yet. We still got two more months left. And when we look back on this, will we really say, 2020, that was one of my favorites. I would love to do that again. And then Nate went on to make some very funny observations about the new realities that we live in because of COVID. But even though we find humor in our current living situations, we need to acknowledge that the very real pressure that this virus has brought into our lives, both as individuals, as families, as a community, as a church. And it takes a toll on us in various ways. And I'm sure we could each make a list of all the things that we don't like about COVID. It may be the way that you now have to do your job. It may be that you've now lost your job because of it. Or maybe you were looking forward to going away to school, and now you're at home online. And it could be that you just desperately miss being together with one another like the way it used to be. And it really, it feels like we're being tested. Like this is a big test. And let's not let COVID just be our only focus, because the reality is there are many other things unrelated to this virus that are testing us. And what they test is our faith in Jesus Christ. And the test goes like this. In your hurt, in your uncertainty, in your confusion, in your frustration, in your anger, in your disappointment, do you turn to Jesus Christ in faith, trusting that He is the one who will be able to help you? And so first, I want to start by having you identify this. Over the past year, what has taken place in your life that has tested your faith in Jesus Christ? I'm going to ask the question again, just give you some time to think about it. Over the past year, what has taken place in your life that has tested your faith in Jesus? And to be fair, some of these things may not have started in 2020. We've maybe been struggling with these things for years, even decades. And the test is this: are you willing to give the troubles of your heart over to Jesus Christ and in faith trust that He is the one who will take care of you? Do you have faith in Jesus Christ? And is it a faith that will trust Him with the trouble of your heart? And I know it can be a scary thing to open up your heart this way. Because you start thinking, what if I do open up my heart this way and things just don't work out the way I think they should? But that's where faith comes in. Faith will trust the outcome to Jesus, that His outcome will help you overcome. Do you know what our faith needs sometimes? Because I think we can struggle in this way. You know what it needs sometimes? It needs a mountaintop moment. It needs a mountaintop moment. We need a chance to get to see life from a different perspective. We need to kind of get high above it all so we can see things in a different light. You know, if you're down in the valley all the time, it's really easy to lose perspective on things. Sometimes our faith needs a mountaintop experience so that it can be strengthened and built up. We need a glimpse of glory. We need to see Jesus in His light so that we can be reminded of who He is and know that we can trust the outcome to Him. This morning, I want each of us to have a mountaintop moment. I want us to climb the mountain this morning with Peter, James, and John and see what they saw, so that our faith may be strengthened and built up. And in verse 2, if you look at it with me, of chapter 9, it says, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain. Jesus knew that his disciples needed this mountaintop experience with him so that their faith would be strengthened. They needed to gain a greater perspective of him. So let's consider, why did Jesus take these three men up the mountain with him? And to help us answer the question, we kind of need to look back at the story so far and remember what's gone on. And there has been this question that continually comes up. And the question is this: who is Jesus? Who is this one who forgives sins? Who is this fella that casts out demons, who heals the sick, who can walk on water, who can calm the storm by his command? Who is Jesus? And we hear him ask the question to his disciples in chapter 8, verse 29. He asked them, who do you say I am? And Peter answered, he said, you're the Messiah. And Peter was right. Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the one God had sent to deliver his people. And it took faith for Peter to say that. But Peter, along with other popular Jewish thinking, thought that the Messiah had come as a conquering Messiah, in the sense that they would free them, that he would free them from their Roman oppressors. But as we learn, starting in verse 31 of chapter 8, Jesus was a suffering Messiah. He told them he would suffer, he would be rejected, he would be killed, and he would rise again 3 days after. In Peter's mind, this is not who the Messiah was. It says in verse 32, Peter took Jesus aside and rebuked him. Think of this for a moment. Peter believed that Jesus was the Messiah. But Peter had so strongly in his mind who the Messiah was that when Jesus told him that he would die and rise again, Peter took him aside and rebuked him and said to Jesus, you know, I don't approve of the way you plan on delivering us. To which Jesus sharply rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. Those would be tough words to hear. Now look at what Jesus said to Peter in verse 33. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. See, Peter had Peter's mind, or concerns in mind, not the concerns of God. Peter rebuked Jesus because Jesus' plans were different than his plans. Can you relate to that? You have in mind how life should be, and then things don't really work out that way. God's plans are different than your plans. And you rebuke God and you say, I disapprove of these hard things that have come into my life. We tell Jesus, I think you got this wrong. This is not how I expected you to deliver me. These hard things test us in our faith. Will you trust Jesus with the trouble of your heart? So why did Jesus take these three disciples up the mountain with him? It's because they needed a mountaintop moment. They needed a greater perspective of Jesus. They needed to see him in his light so that their faith could be strengthened and built up. They had answered correctly, Jesus is the Messiah, but really their vision of Jesus was just, it was too small. He had not come to conquer the Romans. It was greater. He had come to conquer sin and death. Jesus needed them to see him in a different light. And really, the transfiguration is the climactic answer to the question, who is Jesus? So let's climb the mountain together with the disciples and Jesus so that our faith may be strengthened. There are three things that I want us to take away with us today. The first being, on the mountaintop, Jesus' majesty was seen. On the mountaintop, Jesus' majesty was seen. Look at verse 2 with me. It says, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. Jesus was transfigured, and his disciples saw it all. Transfigured means to be transformed, as in Jesus' appearance changed. And I want you to look at the description of this transformation and imagine being on the mountain with Jesus and seeing this. Because the disciples, they walked up the mountain with an ordinary-looking man. But look at what it says. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. In Matthew's account, it says his face shone like the sun. His clothes became as white as the light. In Luke's gospel, it says as Jesus was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. Have you ever seen anyone's appearance change like this? I've had a twinkle in my eye before. But this is something different. There was light emanating from him. Luke says it was as bright as a flash of lightning. I don't know if anyone else saw it, but you see the lightning show we got on Friday night? Wasn't it incredible? I was thinking about the story as I was driving in that. His face shone like a flash of lightning. But what does this all mean? It means that the disciples, they were given this a greater perspective of Jesus. They saw him in a new light. They saw him in his light. But who is Jesus that he would shine like this? What is the light that comes from him? Now, this is not the first time that someone has shone on the top of a mountain. In Exodus 34, God had invited Moses up to Mount Sinai to meet with him. And over 40 days and 40 nights, Moses met with God, and God gave him the Ten Commandments. And in verse 29 of chapter 34, it says, when Moses came down from Mount Sinai, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. Moses' face was shining. Moses had absorbed the light from God, and his face was radiant. It was like Moses was the moon, and God was the sun. And Moses' face reflected God's glory or God's majesty. And God's glory is the radiance of his holiness. It's the radiance of his infinite worth, his infinite value, infinite beauty, his infinite greatness, his infinite perfections is made manifest or made visible in this light that shines. Moses had spent time with God, and God's glory had imprinted on him. Now, is this what happened to Jesus on the mountain? The answer is no. There's something greater at work here. Greater than what happened to Moses. Moses reflected the glory from God. He absorbed it. Moses was like the moon and God like the sun. However, on the Mount of Transfiguration, Jesus is not reflecting God's glory. Jesus is revealing God's glory. The light shines from him. It is his glory. He is the sun. He is not the moon. His glory is made manifest in this light. It's like Jesus in his humanity, he wore a veil. But for a moment on this mountain, the veil was lifted, the curtain was pulled back, and he gives his disciples a glimpse of his glory. Jesus' majesty was seen. Have you ever felt like life has been covered with just dark clouds? At times, everything can just feel kind of grim. The clouds are so thick that you know, the sun can't get through. It's like life lacks vibrancy. This year might make you feel like that. But I was thinking about that. It's like, however, if you ever flown in a plane, you know, if you take off on a really overcast day, isn't it amazing when you break through the clouds and you get high above them? The sun is always shining. It never stopped. My point is this. No matter how difficult things may be, no matter how dark the clouds are, in faith we trust that the sun is always shining in all of his brilliance. The glory that was seen in Christ that day on the mountain will never fade. Have faith. Our Savior is coming for us in power, in majesty. He told his disciples back in chapter 8, verse 38, he will return in all of his Father's glory with the holy angels. In Christ, we will overcome. As the glory of Jesus shone on the mountain, it says in verse 4, and there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Now, the first thing that I want to point out about this is, other than two fellas just supernaturally appeared on the mountain, it's not like they walked up the other side and just happened to bump into Jesus and the disciples. They appeared. What I want to point out is this, is that Moses died about 1,400 years before this. And a little side note, it says in Deuteronomy 34:6, is that when he died, God buried him, and no one knew where his grave was. And Elijah, who's on the mountain with them, well, he'd never died. It says in 2 Kings 2:11, a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared, and Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. And that happened about 900 years before the transfiguration. And I want to say this before we move on. God is able to take care of his people. Where have these two fellows been for all these years? They've been in God's care. Now, how the disciples knew that these two were Moses and Elijah, we don't know. I think an introduction must have happened with Jesus or some explanation later. I don't think they necessarily had name tags with, hello, my name is Moses. But more importantly, the question is why? Why were they there? In Luke's gospel, we're told that they were talking to Jesus about his departure. They were talking about his death and resurrection. And what these two men represent is this. Moses and Elijah, they had important roles in the Old Testament. Moses was the lawgiver, and Elijah was the great representative of the prophets of God. And the law and prophets all pointed to the coming of the Messiah. And here are these two great representatives gathered around Jesus, talking to him about his death and resurrection. And really what this scene is doing is affirming that Jesus is the Messiah and that he would be the one that would bring salvation through his suffering, through his death and resurrection. Jesus is the one that the law and the prophets were all pointing to. In 1 Peter 1:10, Peter writes, concerning this salvation, the prophets searched intently and with the greatest care, trying to find out the time and circumstances to which the Spirit of Christ in them was pointing when he predicted the sufferings of the Messiah and the glories that would follow. Moses and Elijah in faith believed that the day would come, that they pointed towards it. And now here, they stand with Christ just prior to his suffering, prior to his death and resurrection. I want to remind us there is a day coming where we will stand in the presence of Christ. Have faith. In verse 5, Peter is seeing all this, and he says to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And many commentators suggest that at this point, Peter is thinking, the kingdom of God has come. This is it. And he wants to help out. He wants to participate. And he thought that this was the moment that Jesus was coming in his Father's glory, as he had told them back in chapter 8. And Peter's eager to help. And you can kind of see this and appreciate this. It's pretty spectacular what is going on. But Peter had yet to grasp the idea that Jesus first had to die and rise again. And it says Peter did not know what to say. They were so frightened. And it really kind of plays out to me as like, it's one of those moments, you know, when you just say something in the moment, you don't really know what you're saying. At the end, you kind of go, that was kind of foolish to say. And I kind of hear Peter talking to the disciples afterwards saying, you know, it was so incredible. And then I go and say, Jesus, do you want me to set up three tents for you and the other fellows? And it's like, well, how ridiculous. Why did I say that? You know, Jesus' majesty was seen on the mountaintop. And the law and prophets pointed to it. Jesus is the Messiah who died and rose again to deliver us. But that's not all that happened on the mountain. God's voice was heard. God's voice was heard. Look at verse 7. We're told this. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud. This is my son whom I love. Listen to him. If Jesus' transfiguration was not enough, God the Father speaks from heaven to make certain to Jesus' disciples that Jesus is the Messiah and that he had come to suffer, die, and rise again. The mention of the cloud, this is not the first time in Scripture that the cloud has been mentioned. It says in Exodus 24:15, when Moses went up on the mountain, the cloud covered it. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai for 6 days. The cloud covered the mountain, and on the seventh day, the Lord called to Moses from within the cloud. The cloud is a manifestation of divine presence. God spoke to the disciples about Jesus from the cloud. And if you're ever doubting if Jesus is the one who you can trust to take care of your troubled heart, this is God's testimony about him. This voice came from heaven. And he says, this is my son whom I love. Listen to him. Obey him. Trust him. There is no other but him. If God has affirmed from heaven Jesus is the Messiah, the one who will deliver us, what greater voice do we need to hear from? And there are a lot of voices that compete for our attention. Our boss, our spouse, our children, our parents, our friends, people on TV, the latest YouTuber. However, I think the one that competes for our attention the most is our own. But picture, place yourself there. You're standing on the mountain with Jesus. This light is there. And for the, as it says, what they are asking about is a prophet Elijah had been taken out and did in his ministry. This warning would give people his coming. So who is the Elijah that prepared people for Jesus? Because Jesus says in this, Elijah has come. And we know this fellow. But he did not go by the name of Elijah. And the answer is John the Baptist. This prophecy is about John the Baptist. Matthew helps us and tells us in chapter 17, 13, the disciples understood that Jesus was talking about John the Baptist. What we see here is Scripture. Scripture's prophecy was fulfilled. So what do we do with all of this? We climb the mountain with Jesus and his disciples. Jesus' majesty was seen. God's voice was heard. Scripture's prophecy was fulfilled. Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Son of God. We have been given a glimpse of his glory, and one day we will see him in all his glory coming with the holy angels, and all who have faith in Jesus Christ will share in it. I was reading from Peter's second letter this week. He wrote it about 65 years after Jesus' death. And right there in his letter, he writes about the transfiguration. He writes about that mountaintop moment that he had. It was a faith builder for him. And when he wrote this letter, he was nearing the end of his life. That moment helped sustain him through all those years. And he wrote his letter to remind Christians to have faith, to live life in the power of Christ, to live a godly life for Jesus. Why? Because Jesus is, when you think about Jesus' transfiguration, but we gain a greater perspective of him here. Think of that light shining on the mountaintop. It's really like this beacon for all of us who are in the valley. Have faith. Christ will save you. He will bring you through this year. He will bring you through Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for opening our eyes and giving us a glimpse of your glory, seeing Christ but for a moment in all of his brilliance. Lord, we wait the day where we will see Jesus coming on the clouds with the holy angels. We will hear the trumpet call, and we will rise from the dead. We will meet our Savior. God, we love you and we thank you for this hope. I pray that you build faith within us, that you allow us to open our hearts to Jesus Christ, trusting him with the troubles of our heart, trusting the outcome to him. And in our fear, Lord, I pray that we look to you and see that there is no other, there is no one greater to take care of all the pain and hurt in our hearts. Lord, we thank you for the forgiveness that has come through Jesus' death and resurrection. We have been set free, not because of any merit of our own, but because of your great love for us. We don't deserve it, but you have given us life in Jesus' name, and we praise you and we thank you. God, I pray that you just go before us, lighting our way, and use this glimpse of your glory to build with us, in us, a great faith. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to invite Pastor Scott up and the band for a final song.
Would you do something for me? Would you lift your hands with me for a moment and open them and receive from God a blessing. A blessing that will encourage you throughout the week. May this be a moment where we find ourselves on the mountaintop.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. His presence go before you and behind you. Beside you, all around you, and within you, he is with you, he is with you. May his presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you, he is with you, he is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming, and your going, in your weeping, and rejoicing, he is for you. For you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, and your going, and your weeping and rejoicing, he is for you, 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 yes he is, yes he is. Shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you.
Amen. It's so beautiful to hear your voices. You may be seated.
I don't want to leave. I don't want to leave. That was great. God is so good. Just want to close with a few announcements. First off, Marjorie Scott, she'd been a part of our congregation for many years. She went home to be with the Lord this week. But this is what I hold on to in the hope that we have. Marjorie's faith was in Jesus Christ. It says in the Word that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. She has been given a glimpse that we have never seen, but one day we will. If you'd like to reach out to the family, you can send your condolences to Roadhouse and Rose, and they will pass them on to her family. And also, Gloria Nesbitt went home to be with the Lord. Gloria faith was in Jesus Christ, and we trust in Christ that she rejoices in God today. We have been doing our winter clothing drive, which, one, I want to thank you for those who have been bringing in things. We've been filling up the bins. I'll be passing that along shortly. But if you'd like to continue to contribute to the winter clothing drive, we're collecting winter clothes for the York Region Street Outreach Van. And I know it's a great way for us to be able to support our local community and really help with a need that is within our own town. At this time, we want to play a video. We have the Samaritan's Purse Christmas boxes. Once again, we're just going to watch a video that tells us about it.
Of three, when children open the shoe boxes, they are so excited.
Those faces just transform.
Yeah, these kids behind me are so excited because they've just received their boxes.
The mouth is wide open, the voice is raised, smiles are all over. That box brings joy.
We're right now in Phnom Penh in Cambodia. I mean, it's just been incredible. Kids are so excited, giving them a gift. Do it in Jesus' name, and that's what this is all about.
Jesus loves you.
It's a gospel opportunity. It's the chance for the children to change the entire life.
That's what I love about Operation Christmas Child. It knows no borders, it knows no boundaries. It's all about sharing the name of Jesus Christ.
Churches are doing big things with Operation Christmas Child.
Everybody out there who packs shoeboxes, they are spreading God's love.
It's families, it's churches, it's hundreds of thousands of volunteers that help make Operation Christmas Child so successful. We couldn't do it without them.
With this box, they do get the gospel story. They do hear about Jesus.
It has maximum impact in the worldwide kingdom of Christ. I mean, what better thing could you do than be involved and fill shoeboxes?
Some of them go by train, some go by camels, some go by ships. These boxes go all over the world, and that is only the beginning.
After receiving the shoe boxes, the children will be invited to go to the Greatest Journey, which is a 12-lesson discipleship program where they learn about the greatest gift, which is Jesus Christ.
After a child completes the Greatest Journey, they graduate and receive a Bible in their own language.
When the light of the gospel is turned on, that changes everything.
Churches are being planted.
Lives are being changed. Communities are being transformed.
The word of God is spreading. The gospel is advancing.
It is impacting children. It is impacting families. It is impacting the world greatly.
Thank you for praying. Thank you for giving. I would like to ask you to consider packing shoeboxes year-round. God will bless, and God will use your gift to touch the life of a child and to be able to do it in Jesus' name. So thank you. Thank you for being a part of it. God bless each and every one of you.
The Christmas Shoebox Ministry is one that we've participated in for a number of years. Susan McKelvey, she helps lead that. And we are going to be participating again. As you can see by the video, it's a great way for us to be able to share the love of Christ with those around the world. And great things can happen through this. So if you'd like, we have a table set up just outside where you have the shoe boxes. You can grab those, fill them up. They need to be returned by November 15th. And if you can, we'll have them here. If you'd like, also, you can come to the church office during the week and pick them up, and we'll have them here for you. And as we go, I'm going to ask this. Scott, would you be willing just to play that the first verse a few times for us and just send us with this blessing of the Lord? May God go with you, and may he strengthen you in your faith this week, and just hold on to that glimpse of glory that we had this morning together. I love you. God bless you.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you.